Well, it's wonderful to be with you. This is rather large, loud. But, you know, it's great when I was walking around meeting some of you that I've already worked with several of you, and I look forward to an opportunity to get to know more of you in the months and years ahead. I want to thank you for that very warm introduction. I really enjoyed our meeting and look forward to subsequent meetings about how I can serve you and how we can work together to make the university an even better place. And it's an institution that we're all justifiably very proud of. I want to start by acknowledging that we are gathered today on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. And, you know, that is really quite a gift to us as members of this community. Just yesterday evening, I had a chance to say farewell at the retirement party of Al Butker, who some of you may know. And many of you have probably witnessed the transformation of this university when my father was a professor of mathematics here from 1959 until 1963. There were roughly 11,000 students, and there was only one campus here on Point Grey. And some of you have said that you remember my father. And I actually just today drove my car to President's Row. I don't know if any of you know where that is. Near, you know what it is. And the actual house where I was a toddler is still there. It hasn't changed at all. And some of you may know that back then, Joy Kogawa, the acclaimed author, lived there as well, just one house away from our house. And when I saw Joy Kogawa, I said, "Do you remember my family? Do you remember my father?" He said, "Yes, that mathematician that never slept and was always playing the piano." If you've ever been on President's Row, you know that the houses are right next to each other. Probably the walls aren't very thick, and so I can understand that they probably heard lots of piano. And it's interesting, in my family, people are mad about music and mathematics. One is very noisy, and the other is absolutely silent. Except for the sound of a number two pencil on a piece of paper. But, you know, it's really remarkable what has happened here at UBC in just 5 or 6 decades, going from an outstanding university in Western Canada to being what in almost every ranking is recognized as one of the top universities in the world. And my number one message to you as a group is that I understand and recognize that UBC wouldn't be what it is today without your scholarship and your leadership and a participation in many, many committees in creating what UBC is today. So we owe you a debt of gratitude for making UBC what it is today. And we owe a debt of gratitude to the Musqueam people for allowing us to build such a magnificent campus on the unceded territory. Like I said, I'm really pleased to be with you today. Since the very first day I set foot on campus in August, I've enjoyed speaking with now several hundred, if not thousands, of faculty members, staff members and students, and the Maritime faculty. And I hope that this will not be the first, or it is the first time, it won't be the last time, that I'll be invited back to speak with you. I really do want to work together with you to truly make an emeritus college a reality, for it to become a unit where we support you and serve you appropriately, and that it is going to be not only a community for you, but a community that really, I hope, serves as a catalyst to continue to make this community a richer and more vibrant institution. So thank you for your engagement, your intellect, your passion, and your love for the university. And to be frank, thank you for telling me when I'm making mistakes. And thanks for your constructive criticism, because I'm new to UBC. The last time I was here, I was in diapers. So there's a lot for me to learn. And I will be a sincere learner, and I want to understand the history of the institution. Many of you have come to me saying that you want me to understand the history of your unit, of your understanding of the evolution of the institution, and that's incredibly helpful to me. thousands of faculty members and staff have actually already written to me or stopped me on campus to tell me some aspect of the institution that has been really pivotal in my thinking. So I want to thank you in engaging me either by email or directly. As I said, I met with the executive and experienced firsthand from them how dedicated they and you are as a group to UBC. And I want to thank you for that dedication. And I'm going to meet you there so that we can not only acknowledge it, but make sure that your dedication is met with respect, but also support. When I consider how much you have contributed to UBC, I am deeply moved. I know much of your research, not all of it, because it's a very big university, and I don't understand many of the things that you do, because we are so specialized, but from a layman's standpoint, or if you happen to be in a field related to mine, I know how impactful your work has been in moving knowledge forward and creating new knowledge. And you've not only done that through your research and scholarship, written beautiful books that you can see there in the tables behind this room, but you've contributed also in a transformation of our wonderful students and attracting ever brighter students from all around the world. So through your teaching and your research, but in many other ways, you've contributed to making UBC what it is today. You may not know that as a group, you have produced more than $40 million in research funding from tri-councils. And that you have donated $45 million as a group to UBC over the recent years and volunteered in many different activities that are central to what UBC is today and what UBC will become moving into the future. You've given hundreds of talks and conference presentations, thousands of papers, books, and book chapters, and it's only appropriate that we provide the research funding that has been mentioned to support your activities. And that's just the start. You know, the 100,000 for the next 2 years will be something that, as long as I'm here, will be continued. And we will assess whether that is sufficient. If it's insufficient, we will increase that amount. Because we really want to be there to help you continue to go to meetings, continue to do your scholarship, and continue to make an impact in your field. So thank you for the manifold number of ways that you have made UBC what it is today. I know that many of you, I've seen them on your lapel, are members of the Order of Canada, the Royal Society of London, the Royal Society of Canada, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and many other prestigious academies. Some of you, members of the National Academies of Medicine, of Engineering, and of Science in the United States. And that brings great honor to us as an institution. It's incredibly difficult to get into, as an American, it's even harder to get into some of those organizations as an international fellow. So congratulations to you for all of those kudos. Many of you continue to teach credit courses. Some of you still supervise graduate students and mentor junior and senior colleagues. And I can tell you, when I meet with younger junior faculty, that many of them crave that kind of mentorship. Many of the students, some of them jumping over that wall right now, I meet with them one-on-one. And I ask them, why did you come from Halifax? Why did you come from London? Why did you come from Kyoto or Beijing? And the number one reason aren't these beautiful buildings. The number one reason isn't the mountains, or Whistler, or anything like that. I don't know if this surprises you, but the number one reason that they have told me they have come to this institution is because they crave some kind of interaction with that outstanding faculty. It's true for the junior faculty, it's true for the undergraduates, and in meeting with the executive, they've asked me, how do I envision, based upon my experience at Emory University and Cincinnati and Harvard and Johns Hopkins, how do I envision that emeriti professors can be even more engaged? And if my first answer is a very easy one. There's an unmet need among the junior faculty and among the undergraduates. They crave an interaction with you. And so hopefully through the Emeritus College, we can figure out a way to mentor those young scholars and young students in such a way, because that's what will transform their lives more than anything else. So I hope that you will consider that kind of activity. And I know that many of you have already stepped forward to me saying that you'd like to do more of those sorts of things. You were encouraged in the opening remarks to submit ideas to our strategic planning process. So this meeting, this time, is really in many ways ideal for you to provide input. And I'm going to stop talking in a minute so I can hear from you. And I will take mental notes, and then when I get back to the office, I'll write them down of the ideas that you proposed to me here directly. But some of you, I know, would prefer not to speak in such a room and would prefer to communicate one-on-one virtually. So the first thing I want to say is that my email is very easy. Don't use the president's office email, because that's read by somebody else and it's screened in some way. Ultimately, it will get to me, but it takes some time. If you want to communicate with me directly by email, the email address to use is santa.ono@ubc.ca. Please use that. That will come straight to me. It won't go through anyone. And I will do my very best to respond as quickly as I can. And so if you have ideas, constructive criticism, please don't hesitate to email me directly. In some cases, individuals actually want to meet with me one-on-one. So the best way to do that is actually to email me. Don't go through the president's office email, or don't call the office. It's not very efficient. The best way is to email me directly, santa.ono@ubc.ca, and I'll go to my assistant and say, look, let's really try as quickly as possible to make an in-person meeting possible. It may take a little bit of time, because I have a lot of responsibilities, but if you do that, I will really try my very best for us to meet in person. And some of you have said to me that you do want to meet with me in person, and I look forward to that kind of an interaction. Now, more about the strategic planning process. We're right in the midst of it right now. There's a website. I hope that you go to the website. If you Google the Next Century Strategic Plan, UBC, it'll come up. And there's lots of information there. Every single faculty-specific strategic plan is actually found on that website. So you can see the very granular things that are happening in each of the faculties of which you're a faculty member. There's a timeline of the process. It's a very open, inclusive process. There are places where you can upload suggestions or ideas. All of that is read. I have somebody, actually two people, that are reading that information 24/7 and integrating it and bringing it forward to a university-wide strategic planning committee that reads all of that and distills it into different themes. And one of the themes obviously has to do with research and innovation. Another one has to do with teaching and learning. Another one has to do with global connections and so forth and so on. And so all of your ideas will be read by the strategic planning committee. And ultimately what we'll do is we will strike working groups that will take all of the ideas that have been put forward in each of those different thematic areas and prioritize them in a very transparent way. And the ultimate strategic plan, which will be ultimately, hopefully, approved by the Board of Trustees, the governors, will then move to the stage where we'll create an implementation plan. So it might be that through this process, there is a real thirst to increase the number of endowed chairs at the institution. And that it might be that some of them will be interdisciplinary chairs, that professorships that are really, by definition, at their very inception, at the boundary of disciplines or in between different faculties. It's very likely that something like that will occur. And in fact, we're already going to announce in the next several weeks something that I'm very excited about, which is a search for 6 presidential professors. Endowed professorships, that where we will look around all of Canada and all of the world for really transformative, outstanding professors to recruit to the institution. we envision that there'll be other programs that will invest in professors that are already here. And because of the great input from the executive, I think it's very likely that the next strategic plan will have a very specific focus with action steps to support the emeriti in what I hope will be an emeritus college. So please give us your input so that we can find that and put that into the ultimate strategic plan. And this is not just a little document, a glossy document that we'll be putting on a shelf. It'll be something that will inform steps and investments that we'll make in the next 5 to 10 years to really change what UBC is. So I hope that you do engage with us on that. I look forward to seeing the Emeritus College proposal, and I will be supportive of it. And I will be in talking to the finalists for the provost and vice president academic, and I'll tell you that we have outstanding finalists from some of the world's greatest institutions and individuals that have impeccable credentials, and the referencing of those individuals is very, very, very strong. But I'm going to look for a provost and charge the provost as one of their first responsibilities. Their first responsibility is to help establish this Emeritus College. And that's the kind of commitment that I have. It'll be an expectation that I set forward for the provost. There are lots of other things that I can say. I'm looking at my clock, and I'm told that I'm supposed to leave at 3. There's about 45 minutes left. And like I said, I don't like to talk to people. And I wanted to get across, first of all, my thanks to you, and second, my commitment to serve you, some of the things that we're planning to do to align with and support your wishes and your ideas better, and tell you a little bit about what's happening with the provost search, because hopefully the Emeritus College will be supported by the provost, the permanent provost. And then talk to you about how to contribute to the strategic planning process. There's a lot of other pages here that I suggested that I mentioned, but it would be much more valuable for me to talk to you about what you want to talk about. And there might be a number of questions that you have, and if you don't mind, I'm going to vary away from what I've been suggested to talk about and just talk to you and answer any questions. Is that okay with you? I wanted to make sure there was plenty of time for a conversation. Is that okay? Okay. Any questions? Any comments? Go ahead.
Thank you for your remarks. I'm in the Department of Chemistry at UBC.
And you do chemical physics, right?
Chemical physics.
That's right.
Well done. I'd like to raise a point which touches base with this idea of more recognition of emeriti. And I'll preface my remarks by saying that about 30% of emeriti, this is anecdotal, but about 30% continue with scholarly research well past Bismarck's line in the sand of time. About 30% of those, again, and this is again anecdotal, continue at a very high level of research. They're invited to international conferences, they get research grants, as you said, they mentor students and so on. The people, this type of performance from emeriti, were they still on the active faculty, would certainly make them candidates for, if not recipients of, merit awards for jobs well done. There's no such thing, as far as I know, for emeriti. I think that's wrong. I think that the recognition of the scholarly research of emeriti has long been ignored by this university, and I'm very encouraged by your remarks that things are going to change. So I have one suggestion in that regard.
Go ahead.
You want to get in there first?
Go ahead. I'm listening.
I'd like to suggest the creation, I've done so before actually, of a position, a titled position, Research Professor Emeritus.
Okay.
Or Research Scholar Emeritus, that could be discussed. And the point would be threefold, I would say. First, recognition. Recognition is important. It's important in the active faculty, it's important in the emeritus faculty, and as you've already said, many are continuing research, and I have just re-emphasized, at a very high level. That is so far not a mechanism at UBC. The second is, it's very difficult for a Meritai to get research grants. Were such a titled position to be recognized by the granting agencies, that would probably help at upping that ante. And the third reason I would say is there's a large number of what you might call virtual retirees who, because of the abandonment of mandatory retirement, are no longer forced to retire. I mean, that's fair enough. But those that might be thinking in that direction, were there some encouragement to continue on at a high level of the research they're doing, for example, by such a title position, that might encourage more to move in that direction. So I will be very happy to discuss this with you in person. I know your email.
Everybody does.
I want to mention it because I think it's the way to go. And it would help a lot for those people that continue and then write a paper and then they cite UBC and so on and so forth. And maybe they get an email on their department posting, well done, so and so. That's not enough.
We want to do more than that.
Good. Great.
So first of all, thanks for those suggestions. Could you please email me with, first of all, those three comments,
yes,
suggestions, and then let me read them, discuss it with others, because I can't do anything unilaterally, as you know.
Well,
many of these things do have to go through the Faculty Senate.
Of course.
I appreciate your comments, and I've been at many different institutions where there are some of those have been adopted at different institutions, and there are mechanisms to do so. So the first thing is email me those three. Let me discuss them with the executive, the provost, and the faculty senate. And I'm happy to respond about how things are going. And if there are challenges associated with that, I'll be very honest about what those challenges are. At the appropriate time, we should talk. I would enjoy that.
So. Go ahead and get to those Irish stuff.
No problem. Go ahead.
Well, thank you, Professor Omar. I'm Ken Craig, Professor Emeritus in the Department of Psychology. I have a somewhat unique perspective on emeriti organizations across Canada. I presently serve as the president of the College and University Retiree Associations of Canada, and it's a federation of 41 organizations of this type. UBC is truly exemplary, not that I want to engage in an inimical comparison with other organizations, but this is just really an outstanding group. And it makes me think, and I've said this in a response on the survey, but it makes me think that UBC is truly in a unique position to establish some exemplary structures that would lead the way across Canada and throughout North America in terms of tapping the resource, not only for UBC, but for British Columbia and Canada and the rest of the world, by recognizing these truly remarkable people that you've already described in some detail. So thinking structurally about what could be done with the university, the Maritime College is an excellent idea, and I think we can really build on that.
Well, the executive hasn't talked to me, but I encourage them to study what Emory University has done. Emory University has an outstanding emeritus college, Maritime College they call it, and I worked directly with them when I was a senior vice provost there, and deputy provost. And so I know how robust that group is, and I encouraged the emeriti professor at Cincinnati to visit them and to provide me with a proposal. So, you know, I expect to work together with you, with the provost being really the front person, but I'll be supportive and I'll be keeping an eye on progress. I fully intend to make our support of emeriti professors best in class in Canada. That's my mission, that's my goal, and I will be stubborn about it, I hope the Faculty Senate will help me, and so let's work together, and let's really think about, like I said, what we've done so far. I've only been here for 7 months, is the first step. We will have many, many steps, and we will get there. So, thank you.
I'm Judith Hall. I'm Emeritus Professor of Pediatrics and Medical Genetics. And I also want to thank you for coming and for your very supportive attitude. And I think we want to see UBC move from excellence to eminence as well. And one of the classifications has to do with the number of awards, major awards, that are received. And as you probably know, most eminent universities have an Office of Major Award with professional writers. We have not, and we need it. We emeriti have taken, so to speak, the bull by the horns, and the scholarly committee has formed a nominations committee. For the last 2 years, we have been nominating emeriti that should have been nominated. And we are being successful, and we're really delighted. But we would urge you to establish an Office of Major Awards and take our work away from us, but we'll support it in any way we can.
We haven't announced this yet. I'm still working through the budget, but we've already set aside money to do exactly that. And so thank you for that. And we want to... But I want to thank you for the leadership that you and others have really played in helping to support. That process is not easy. There's a lot of work involved. You have to identify the 10 top papers and change the CVs and put asterisks next to each of the trainees and write long letters and convince other people from other institutions to write letters when they're already busy. I understand what it's like. So thank you for the leadership that all of you have played. In that, I realized it was one of the first things I recognized when I arrived, that unlike Emory and unlike Harvard and unlike Johns Hopkins, that had invested in really providing substantial support for that, that was something that was lacking. And despite that, it's amazing that we have 218 Royal Society of Canada members, even without such an office. Just imagine what it would be with such an office. So we will be supporting that moving forward.
So, this is Richard Tease.
Everybody knows Richard.
Some bitterly, but anyway, what I was going to say is that one of the things we've done over the past, I think, 10 years, is try and create this organization, broaden it, and make it more eminent, I suppose. But I think one of the things we've discovered, because we have departmental reps, so in addition to the executive and so on, we have people in it. Not every, but probably 80% of the departments and faculties across campus. And what is clear to us after this time is how emeriti are treated, how they're honored, how their resources are being used is quite uneven. So there are departments and faculties where this is done exactly as you would like. And they have resources, they need money for a research grant or do something or get some Xeroxing done, it's done. If they need their computer fixed, it's fixed. They have offices, etc. And there are others where this is not true. They also utilize their emeriti in committees on recognition and so on, the kinds of things that you would like to see done. And clearly they're interested in supporting their department in some sense. And so this is a job in the sense of education in some ways, that the department heads and some of the deans need to understand that this is to their advantage to do this in all the departments in their domain. And it would be helpful if you were a cheerleader at times, and particularly with the new provost being recruited, vice president of research and so on. These are opportunities for you to direct others who will actually try and do something about this to make sure that this is done more universally across the campus, because I think it would be cheap, and I think that it also would be very useful for the university. So.
Thank you for that. I will definitely be your cheerleader, and I will definitely, as I said, work with the provost and make sure that this is a priority for the new provost. And I'll be coming back, if you'll have me, regularly, and so you can hold me accountable to things getting more uniform and standardized across the institution. I hope one of the things that the Emeritus College will be able to do will be to perhaps formulate guidelines for what is expected across the institution. And I'm happy, and we can work on those together, And then I'm happy to go to the Council of Deans and be not only a cheerleader, but to walk through what is the appropriate way to significantly support and honor an emeriti professor across the institution.
Not related to emeriti, but related to our university. You mentioned the fact that you're going to be seeking stars for the six chairs that you've got. One of the things, I serve on the Senate Budget Committee. I was in a department that grew itself into one of the top departments in the world. And one of the things that struck me, because we didn't have a lot of resources, was to build from the bottom. That is, it seems to me that the recruiting process, we need assistant professors who are going to turn out to be the stars. They're less expensive. However, the ability to do that, to get the right people and to recruit them successfully, is going to be most important, because we're not going to have as much money as some of our peer universities have. So, for instance, I think it was the last Senate Budget Committee, the Faculty of Medicine was reporting in with respect to its debt. And they only had 8% of their faculty were assistant professors. And fundamentally, that's a dangerous situation to find ourselves in, because our reputation will last longer than it probably deserves, but the people who are going to maintain that are, in fact, the young faculty members who are going to grow up, hopefully be mentored by emeriti, but at least be helpfully selected and make a real difference 10 years, 20 years down the road.
Yeah, I just want to be very clear. When I talked about this initiative, that this is just something which is happening in this first year. And it's also tied a little bit to likely federal funds that we think are going to be released because of the geopolitical changes. So it probably hasn't escaped anybody's notice that Canada is a very attractive destination now because of what's happened south of the border and also what's happening with Brexit. I mean, the UK is, and England is, they've submitted a letter, and so it started. And so perhaps it doesn't surprise you that it's not only students, you know, applications to UBC from students, prospective students have gone up 25% at a minimum, and in some faculties even more. And so it's become incredibly attractive destination, Canada, but specifically UBC, to students, but also to faculty. There are, some of you may know from talking to your colleagues in departments, searches that have closed with Americans or British faculty almost banging down the doors, saying, please open it because we want to be in the search, because we want to move to Canada. And that's not only happening at junior ranks, it's also happening at individuals that are Nobel class. We are, as an institution, right now talking to at least 6 to 8 individuals of that class that want to leave Harvard, University of Chicago, and Caltech because of what's happening in the United States. It's pretty exciting. The federal government has noticed that this might be an opportunity, and they've actually asked me and others, the presidents of McGill and Toronto, to talk to them about what we're experiencing. And it hasn't been announced yet, but I think there's a good possibility there'll be federal money to help with this kind of senior recruitment. So the reason why we're leading with that is because we think that there'll be a matching component, and that we now have this bolus of interest in UBC as destination from those ranks. But I think in subsequent years, absolutely, we will recruit junior faculty as well. And your analysis of the situation in the Faculty of Medicine is right on the mark. The good news is that what may not be clear is that in this upcoming year, because I study the budget line very carefully, it's one of my jobs, that what you may not know is that the deficit is going to shrink considerably this year. The problem with that is that it's not only because of efficiencies in administration that's happened, but also because there hasn't been hiring for far too long. And so that's the dirty side of the story. I don't want to speak out of turn yet, but my intention is, in the near term, to reverse that de facto hiring freeze in medicine. because I know that hiring junior faculty is essential. Now, that being said, I also need to work very hard with the federal government and the provincial government, because as you know, in this budget, $950 million have been given to industry-led research clusters. And so we're really dependent upon industry to work with us, to identify ways that we can collaborate with them in hopefully ways that will be consistent with the research that our faculty want to pursue. And what hasn't been announced, as you know, is any increase in Tri-Council funding. For that reason, it has become, in a very diplomatic way, I'm already working very hard to make it clear, and I've already been meeting with other presidents and also Alan Bernstein from CIFAR. We have to do everything we can to reverse that, because it's very, very difficult to get Tri-Council funding now. And it's even harder if you're a new faculty member. So I want to be very honest with you, careful about recruiting lots of junior faculty member into a climate where they may not be able to get any kind of funding. And so I'm putting as a major priority right now in this initial year, trying to influence the federal government, please don't tweet this or anything like that, because you have to be very diplomatic about it, that Canada must support fundamental research. And if it doesn't, then we'll lose a whole generation of future faculty. So I hope you understand that. I have to be a little bit strategic about when I recruit, what kind of faculty members and how I influence the chances that they will be successful once they arrive here, and that they'll be successful in the competitive fields that they will enter. So I hear you. I plan to do it. And I may turn to you, some of you, to help me convince the federal government to reintroduce sufficient funding for fundamental scholarship.
I'm Daniela Larry from the History Department. I work on Chinese history. I'm retired, obviously. I wonder if you could say something about your vision for the university's engagement with Asia. You can see from our student body, we can tell how important it is, although many of them are native-born Canadians. We have had a very strong faculty in all aspects of Asian studies. But many of us are retired now. Yes. And we have a problem recruiting new faculty, not just other jobs, but can they actually afford to move to Vancouver, which a small but point I don't think needs belaboring. I would be very grateful for whatever you could tell us about where you see UBC going in the future.
So that's absolutely, first of all, with respect to Asian studies, Asian research, and the discussions that are happening right now about potentially amalgamating the Institute of Asian Research with the Liu Institute,
yes,
that there are some concerns about whether that will dilute focus on something that is globally recognized, with UBC being one of the top five or so, yes, centers for Asian research and scholarship. And so I'm very, very aware of all of those tensions and all of those concerns. I can say that I'm familiarizing myself with a plan from the Faculty of Arts to reinvest into the building, Institute of Asian Research, and also the Asian Center needs investment. It has a great library, but not all the books are used, and so I'm aware of the strategy there to renovate and repurpose it so that it needs refurbishment, definitely. And so it is very much on my radar screen. I think that when I travel to Asia, the UBC brand is huge. Probably much bigger than the UBC brand in Baltimore, Maryland. Everybody in Hong Kong and China knows UBC, and they want to work with us. And it's no secret that that right now in the United States, where they're talking about eliminating the NEH and the NEA and cutting NIH funding by up to 30%, that when you view that, and then view the contrast of when I go to China, and other Asian countries about how they're really significantly investing in fundamental scholarship, that our connections and brand name in Asia is an asset. Many other Canadian universities have told me that they're envious of our standing and reputation and true links with the best Asian institutions. So I think it would be a mistake if we didn't capitalize on that, we didn't make sure that those significant relationships were maintained or even grow. And there are a number of things that we're thinking about. In April, I'm traveling to the University of Tokyo, one of the premier national universities in Japan, and they very much want to strengthen and broaden the relationship with us. And we have relationships in Asian studies, but we also have really, really world-class relationships in quantum matter with the University of Tokyo. So I'm going there first to sign an agreement, a trilateral agreement between the Max Planck Institute, University of Tokyo, and UBC. But I'm also there to meet with the presidents of the best universities in Japan to explore how they might collaborate to support faculty to engage in those sorts of things. So when I come back in April and May, hopefully I'll be able to talk about real initiatives that can really support the kind of efforts that you mentioned. It's something that David Strangway made possible, and you know, those are big shoes to fill. You know, I will work very hard to do everything I can, as he did, to support those activities. So hopefully that's all. Now, the second point is not a minor point, and it's worth belaboring. You said you didn't want to belabor it. That has to do with the fact that I talked to some of you, and some of you were able to buy houses in Dunbar and other areas because it was affordable back then. I actually even looked at a job at UBC around 2000, 1999. And I remember back then, buying a small house in Burnaby was going to cost me $1 million, and that was quite a stretch for me in 1999. But now those same houses are probably $4 million, and the houses in Dunbar are probably $4 or $5 million. And it's very hard for a junior faculty member to afford that. And I've talked to Charles in Asian research, and we've talked about that. I think that UBC can do more, and as you know, we're working on a housing action plan. We've increased the amount of money we put aside for low-interest loans, and the amount of loans that we're making is growing in size because the cost of housing is growing, and so we're trying to grow that pot and increase the amounts. We will start to build more housing, not market housing, to raise money for our endowment. That's much of that has been the strategy up until now. In future years, we hope to change the proportion of build, because we still have quite a bit of land to build on. And we hope to increase the amount of housing, which is quite significantly, hopefully discounted, to make it possible for junior faculty to live on campus. So those are the strategies. I don't think we can do it alone. UBC can't do it alone. I mean, we have an advantage over SFU and other institutions or UVic, and that we have land that we can build upon. I think this is a Vancouver problem, and I've mentioned that to the mayor of Vancouver and to the premier Christy Clark. You've probably seen some things, murmurs about this in the Vancouver Sun. I'm one of the people that's really advocating for a province-wide solution. There are many municipalities around the world where they have actually designated areas for development for affordable housing for especially young new recruits to the area. I think it's going to be needed. I'm sorry, my phone is ringing. I turned it off. But it is something that's very well worth belaboring and continuing to focus on in the years ahead. That was the chair of the board. I just hung up on him. He's an emeritus professor. Okay.
My name is Cheryl Grace, and again, I'd like to thank you for coming. Thank everything you've said has been amongst the most. Oh, sorry. Was I silent?
I can hear you.
Okay. Cheryl Grace, English. Thank thank you for coming. Everything you've said has been, I think, over the top of the most positive I've heard in 4 decades of being at UBC. I would just make 2 comments. One going back to some of the things that Richard raised, younger faculty and so on, and then your comments about tri-councils. The funding, as you know full well, for the councils is dropped for sure. It is very, very low. And one of the worst aspects of the SHRC funding is its inability to sufficiently award postdoctoral fellowships. I've had postdoctoral fellows in my career, and I think they are extremely important, but to get a SHRC postdoc has become, they stopped offering them. You're offering them again, I believe, and it was difficult, almost impossible. The Killams were very blessed, very difficult, and there's the Banting. It might be worth considering, and this may be logistically possible, to have a UBC postdoctoral fellow program and fund some postdoctoral fellowships that way and bring in new people. I was sitting here wondering whether I would say this, and I'll say it, though I'm mixed in my own feelings, that emeritus, I'm still supervising, I've got 1 grad student left, and yet I feel to supervise students, although it's a wonderful thing to do, really should be with the regular working pre-retirement faculty members because they need it. They need it for their research, they need it for their own advancement in their career, and so on. So I would be reluctant to say that we should be allowed to do that. But perhaps the postdoctoral fellowships, those of us still engaged actively in research, could have a role there. The other thing I wanted just to comment on, be sure that it gets your attention if it hasn't already. We have at UBC the premium journal field of the study of Canadian literature. It is over 50.
They come to see me.
They have. And I would hope that would be on your radar as something to continue to support. We are known around the world for that journal. Recently, a Chinese scholar visiting with me came in large part because of Canadian studies and because of that journal. We also have the McLean Chair, and that needs to be that program. Needs to be fostered and nurtured. It's important, and Canada always has been, an outward-looking country to the world, but we mustn't forget that we need to know ourselves. And UBC is very highly distinguished in that area.
Let me try to remember all the points. So can you just remind me, because there are several points there. Can let them come to see me. As you know, some of that funding is relying upon support from the Faculty of Arts. And so, you know, I need to have an on. So there's a interim appointment there, you know, and then the permanent dean is coming back, and so it's already on my radar screen, and I will continue to talk to them. You know, I would hope that they will continue to make it a priority. If not, then it doesn't mean that the university will not step in. And so, you have my email address, santa.com@ubcsca. Please make all those points specifically. Don't forget about CanLit. Postdoctoral fellows. I'm on the board of directors for the Killam. And it's a very important time right now because the whole program is being assessed. As you know, UBC is fortunate to be one of the 5 or 6 possible recipients of Killam funding. And people don't realize that the Killam endowment is larger than the Rhodes endowment. And so there's a real thought. The board of directors has been asked to think about whether it should remain with the host institutions, whether it should be broadened, whether some of it should be used for a prize. I'm actually against that. We don't need more prizes. You know, should we really put $1 million and give it to one person? We don't need that. The impact, what I'm trying to say is that the impact that the Killam has on UBC is enormous. If you sop away that money and put it into one gold medal, the negative effect of UBC will be enormous. I'm really advocating for the Killam to continue to support in the multiple levels that it already does. And second, In terms of a UBC postdoctoral program, that's the kind of thing you really need to make a specific recommendation to me and think a little bit about how it would be structured. I was at Harvard University, they have the Society of Fellows. They're senior fellows, and you can think about this. I actually instituted this idea at the University of Cincinnati. We have a graduate Society of Fellows, which is competitive to get into. And then what I asked is, well, what are we doing for the postdoctoral fellows and the graduate students? Harvard has a junior Society of Fellows, where they meet regularly with the senior fellows, where they're given financial support directly to address your issue. They also have, in addition to meeting with the senior fellows, they have mentors. And it has had a huge impact on postdoctoral fellows at Harvard University and junior faculty. So please make that specific recommendation. This is the time when we're thinking about how we allocate our resources and how we fundraise. I would love to fundraise to create such an entity here at UBC, but it really can't be top down. It'd be great if you could recommend it to the committee. The committee then says, Santa, they want to do this. Can you go out and pound the pavement and try to raise the money? I will do that. So please make that a suggestion. There's somebody back there.
Thank you. I appreciate everything that you said to us today. I wish you a very happy tenure as president. But I also want to pay tribute to Monty Python and talk about something completely different.
Okay.
I hope that you will allow and promote democracy at UBC. You remarked at the start of the session here that when you first inhabited UBC, it was a campus with 11,000 students, as I recall, surrounded by gorgeous Douglas fir forests with wild elephants and lions and tigers prowling around. Now there are tens of thousands of students, there's lots of faculty, there are thousands of employees, and for years now, UBC has been developing market housing for, we hear at different times, 20,000, 30,000, perhaps 50,000 residents. And yet, UBC is not part of Vancouver. UBC is not part of any municipality. Fact which I have sometimes discussed with friends in California around Stanford and so forth, they're stunned. How can it not be subject to some kind of local electoral authority? But it isn't. The result is, I think, that you have baffled residents who don't know who's responsible for the parking regulations, who's responsible for picking up the garbage after there's been a beer fest on some of the green space. I have no idea why UBC went ahead and developed all this market housing without any proper negotiation with the city of Vancouver regarding the traffic that goes back and forth along, say, Marine Drive or 16th Avenue or 4th Avenue. And at times, I have seen the university administration go through very strange contortions to support the University Neighborhood Association and describe it as a municipal light authority. And yet, year after year, nothing changes. And personally, I think that the lack of democracy and the lack of responsibility to some surrounding citizenship is partly why UBC has got itself in a position where it doesn't have affordable housing for faculty members or for postdocs or for graduate students, because it's just another real estate development company. I don't think that's really an appropriate stance for an institution of higher learning. And in many ways, UBC actually resembles a sort of 19th century mining company town.
I've never been to one, so. So I hear you, and
I remember that.
Okay. Okay, I hear you, and I want to thank you, and I just hope you do realize that the evolution of UBC is something that I haven't had any control on, right, like that. And so I'm hearing you, and you know, I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about the steps you think I can take. I understand that some people view me as the mayor of Point Grey. I have never seen any evidence of the fact that I have such powers. But I would love to talk to you about, honestly, seriously, about what you think I can do to address the evolution of UBC from the 19th century on the town it was. So I look forward to that. What's your name, by the way?
Ned Blitt.
Okay.
I was in several departments and several different faculties at different times.
Okay. Well, thank you for that question.
I'm not easy to live with.
That's okay. I live with many, many different people in many different institutions. So.
I think we're going to have to call things to a close. I'd love to stay here all afternoon and listen. I've been very, very generous with your time.
I didn't answer this question, though. You asked whether I would be supportive of democracy. Absolutely. No question about it. Well, thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to the next time. Thank you very much.
We celebrate Vancouver climate every time we have a guest speaker, every time we have an honored speaker, you're not a guest. And to you goes the very coveted America's umbrella.
Thank you very much.